Good morning. I want to welcome you to Emmanuel Church this morning. Welcome you here on this Father's Day. And so I hope you had that opportunity to express your love and care for your father today. I will be attempting to take a nap on my new hammock that they set up for me before they took off to Jalapa. So that's what we're hoping for this afternoon. So, Norlin, keep me awake during the message. So, by the way, with us today, preaching, thank you very much, Norlin, is Reverend Norlin Van Beek. He's the director of Inspiration Hills Bible Camp, and before that at Ironton, and before that, well, I won't keep going because I would hate to tell him how old you are. So it's great to have Norlin with us today and have somebody that I can give a hard time to and then sit down and let you do my work for me. So it's wonderful. Want to just give you a couple things to think about this week. If you are having kids that you want to sign up for Kids Fest, that opens Wednesday. And remember, there are limited spots in the different groups. And so if you have a certain group that your kids really want to be in, Wednesday would be a good day to be getting online and signing up for that. And if you have any troubles with that, Lorna said you can call her. So call Lorna. And then finally, too, just a reminder, I'm running a new members class or a profession of faith class beginning next week and going for the next 3 Sundays, and we'll meet in that back classroom beginning after church next week. Let's stand this morning as the Lord our God has preceded us in this place and looking to Psalm 121 for our call to worship. I lift up my eyes to the hills. Where does my help come from?
My help comes from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth.
Of all creation, of water, earth, and sky, the
about the wonders of God, and it being Father's Day, we think especially about passing that on to the next generation. And we are to be telling our children all the wonders of God, the miracles of the universe, the miracles of salvation.
Of God, our Savior Jesus Christ, have received a faith as a precious gift as ours. Grace and peace be yours in abundance through the knowledge of God and the love of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. As we've been greeted by the Lord, please turn to each other and greet each other in the name of the Lord. I see a red light, and that always causes me concern. Green light means go, right? So I should stop, and it's red. Would you please turn to page 976 as we prepare to celebrate the Lord's Supper in a week? Page 976, there's places to respond together. One of the beautiful opportunities to celebrate the community of the church while remembering Christ's work for us and then installing and remembering the hope that we have in Christ because of his work on the cross. As we prepare to celebrate Holy Communion, let us remember that Scripture calls us to examine ourselves before God. We are taught that eating and drinking unworthily brings judgment upon ourselves. So let us therefore ask God for the proper spirit in which to celebrate this sacrament. Almighty God, before whom can be neither secret thought nor hidden deed, grant us your spirit, that we may know our hearts and our lives and our inmost thoughts as you know them. Grant us your grace, that we may repent sincerely of all our sin, find peace with you through our Lord Jesus Christ, and grow in assurance of a salvation in him. May the celebration of our Savior's infinite love and his redeeming death bring joy to us and give glory to you.
We thank you, Heavenly Father, for the atoning power of our Savior's death and for our share in his victory over sin. Open our hearts as we prepare for this celebration, that it may strengthen us in our faith, establish us in our hope, and confirm us in our love. In his name, amen.
Brothers and sisters, let us first examine our faith. We all confess the truth of God as taught by Scripture and summarized in the creeds of this church. By this faith, we take to ourselves Christ and all his benefits, for so that for us to live is Christ.
Lord God, author and finisher of all true believing, confirm our faith as we prepare for the Holy Sacrament.
Let us further examine our hope. All Christian hope rests upon the finished work of Christ as Savior. The Holy Gospel teaches us that all our righteousness is in him alone. God's children rely wholly upon the merits of Christ, find in him their strength and victory, and confidently expect his return in glory. They look forward to celebrating this Holy Supper anew with him in the kingdom. They will surely be received by God at his table.
Most merciful Father, fill us with all joy and peace in believing, so that by the power of the Holy Spirit we may abound in hope.
Let us also examine our love, both for God and our neighbors. Remember the first and great commandment to love the Lord our God with all our heart, soul, mind, and strength. Let us consciously determine to live a life of loving service to him through Christ our Lord. Let us also search ourselves to determine whether we love our neighbor as Christ commands. Do we unselfishly live for the welfare of others? Do our lives reflect the godly virtues of obedience, fidelity, integrity, justice, humility, and contentment? Do we seek reconciliation with our neighbors in all cases of offense?
Dear Father, daily increase in us the greatest gift of all, our Christian love.
If these marks of spiritual life are not evident in us, we may not presume to approach this table. Those, therefore, who live in self-righteousness, who hope in works or virtues of their own, and who do not show love to God and neighbor, have no true place at the Lord's Supper. Yet we should not be deterred by any lingering sin within us against our will. As we find faith, hope, and love within us, we ought gladly to obey our Lord's command and come with full expectation to God's open house of mercy.
Gracious God, we love and adore you in Christ our Lord. We thank you for reconciling us to yourself in him. We rejoice in being received as your children. Prepare us by your Holy Spirit for the sacrament. Help us to come in the assurance that by it we shall be spiritually revived and strengthened in faith, hope, and love. Through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Let's close this in prayer, shall we? Father, thank you for the gift and the opportunity of celebrating with you and through you your victory, your rescuing us, Lord. We praise you for the hope, the love, the peace, and the faith that you've given us. Lord, help us in our unbelief. Guide us and prepare our hearts to be with you now and always. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. And now we're going to have an offering. And as that offering is taken, we'll be watching a video of the Father's Song. Thank you.
it over me and for eternity. It's written on my heart. Heaven's perfect melody, the Creator's symphony. You are singing over me, the Father's song. Heaven's perfect mystery, the King of love has sent for me. And now you're singing over me, the Father's song. I have heard so many songs, listened to a thousand tongues, but there is one that sounds above them all, sounds above them all. The Father's song, the Father's love, you sung it over me and for eternity. It's written on my heart. Heaven's perfect melody, the Creator's symphony. You are singing over me, the Father's song. Heaven's perfect mystery, the King of love has sent for me. And now you're singing over me, the Father's song.
Prayer to look to God's word together. Let's stand and let's sing about that Father in heaven and his love for us. Please stand.
Time.
Searching and us searching is something that is just resonating throughout our culture today, and we'll get more into that as we go. The first Father's Day, I always got to look up why and where things started, but I found out that the first Father's Day was celebrated in a single church in June 19, 1910. Young lady, Sonora Dodd, went to her church and wanted to acknowledge her father. Her father raised six kids as a single parent and wanted to honor him. Later on, after she had gone through school, then she began to make it a national movement, but it wasn't put into an official presidential proclamation until 1972 by Johnson. I asked my wife, I said, you remember growing up Father's Day? And there's a time I remember starting, but it's one of those things I don't remember doing as a kid. That tells you how old I am now. But Mother's Day has been going on for like 60 some years. Not sure why that is. Or do we, huh? That's part of the rest of the story, but I want to begin by asking a question. What is one thing that you value most? What is the one thing that you value most? And I guess I better get going here. What is the one thing you value most? I don't want any feedback now. I'll ask for that probably later. And what is your greatest treasure? What is your greatest treasure? And maybe even ask this question, what is one thing you can't live without? What is one thing you can't live without? Well, we're going to begin with Matthew 6, verse 19. And I invite you to take your Bibles and open your Bibles to that if you have them or in the pew.
We're going to focus on verse 33, and there's going to be a few other verses that we're going to touch on too a little bit. But as the bulletin stated, these are words from Jesus as he preached on the side hill. And a lot of these words were new, were fresh, were controversial, scandalous, even some of them. The Pharisees were right there listening, of course, and they had an eye for earthly things. While they were trying to teach Scripture, trying to teach Judaism, they had an eye on wealth and a lot of self-righteousness. And Jesus, of course, is turning that upside down. We're going to start reading in verse 19. Do not store for yourselves treasures on earth, where moths and vermin destroy. And I think some translations say rust. Where thieves break in and steal. But store for yourselves treasures in heaven, where moths and vermin did not destroy, and where thieves did not break in and steal. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. And now we're going to jump to verse 33. But seek first the kingdom and his righteousness, and all these things will be given to you as well. Verse 34, therefore do not worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will worry about itself. Each day has enough trouble of its own. Let's pray together. Father, as we've read your word, we pray, Lord, for your spirit to lead and guide us in your truth. May it, Lord, call us and draw us closer to you, and help us, Lord, to look honestly within ourselves, the things that may be drawing us away. Father, we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. So again, the question is, what is your greatest treasure? I'm going to kind of do a sidebar here for a moment. I'm going to call our attention to our changing culture. I acknowledge that some of us didn't have a good father growing up, but there are other things going on in our culture. 40 to 50% of foster home children will not complete high school. 80% of the prison population came from broken homes, and one of the gals that works with us at the Hill meets with 30 women weekly for a Bible study, and all 30 of them came from a broken or foster care home. When I say that, it's not the foster care home that's necessarily the problem, is it? 96 of American families have some form of dysfunction. That number has almost doubled in the last 20 years. 66% of foster home children will be homeless or go to jail or die within a year of leaving the foster care system. Children from single-parent homes are 80% more likely to commit a major crime by the age of 25. The number of children that fall into the trauma category will likely be 80% by the year 2022. That number is about 55% last year. So what's missing? What's missing? It says, these are the three things we're going to take a look at. Store up for yourselves treasures in heaven. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. And seek first the kingdom of God. Those are the three things we're going to focus on. The first one, store for yourselves treasures in heaven. Where do we store up treasure? What kind of treasure do we have? And what is our greatest treasure? Well, Matthew is referring to a treasure that no one can take with you when you die. We all know that, right? We can't back up to earth. We can't sell the things that we have and take it with us to heaven. We can't take our reputation. We can't take our success. That has no value in heaven. I'm not sure if you've heard of this joke, but there was a man who did decide to cash in all his wealth, turn it into gold, put it in his coffin, and expected to have that with him when he got to heaven, which he did. And Peter says to him, "Why did you take paving material?" That's what value it has in heaven. It's what we see as valuable in heaven is of no value. We also have to ask a little bit, is what is heaven? If you're going to store up treasure there, what is about heaven that makes that a valuable place or a place to want to be? And of course, as believers, we know that heaven is real. It is where God resides and is waiting for us, as Jesus told his disciples, that he went to prepare a place for them and that he would return and they would be with him forever. The only way to get there, though, we know, is through Christ. Jesus, in his word, said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father who resides in heaven except through me." For me and all believers, for us and all believers, our greatest treasure, I would hope you would say, is Christ. The only thing that we have to store up in heaven is that relationship with Christ, with the exception of our other relationships. And obviously we can't grab somebody and take them to heaven with us, but the influence that we have and what we pour into the lives of people around us, reflecting God's love and his grace and his mercy, allow us to build that treasured relationship, and Lord willing, we'll have that relationship once again in heaven. A number of years ago, Kevin and I and a bunch of other pastors did a series on heaven, and we talked about the continuity of life in heaven. And one of those things being our relationships, that we will certainly know each other while there. But I don't want to inflict guilt on any father or suggest that what we do here and the success we have or the money we earn or the things we have are necessarily bad, but it's how we treasure them. What value do we put on them? What value do we put on gaining that? And what cost do we give to have those things? There are many, many fathers, and probably mothers as well, more recently, that regret the time and the energy that they spent in their career while sacrificing their children and their relationship with them. Our relationship is our greatest treasure, that first with Christ and then with others. And then Jesus reminds us that for that to have any value is to seek God's kingdom first and to have that as our goal and our yearning and our desire to remain in heaven with him. So that's our next question. What are we to seek first? Jesus tells us, seek first the kingdom of God. Seeking first means that kingdom, that you have a king. And for that to be a good relationship, you better know the king, right? That's what a relationship is. You grow in knowing by spending time. You better know the king as well as his son. Jesus spent time with his disciples and told them that if you want to know my father, then you should know me. And when you know me, you will know my father. My father and I are one. And that's the relationship that he's building into his disciples to go out and to share. And then if we back up even a ways into chapter 6 of Matthew, Jesus teaches them how to pray and says, this is how you should pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Jesus is inviting the disciples into that relationship with his Father, calling it our Father, and into that relationship with a kingdom that will come. I pray that it's an inseparable relationship for us and our greatest value and our greatest treasure to have and know the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. So the question remains, is Jesus your greatest treasure? And what are you storing up? Where is your heart? Where do you invest your time and your energy? Where would your kids or grandkids say you invest that time and energy? And then what are we doing? What are we seeking first? Remember the identity crisis? Our changing culture? Reading those numbers, and there's a whole lot more numbers that we could talk about. The question is, what is missing? And it doesn't take long to figure out that fathers, for one, are missing, and parents together are missing in many cases. What we have to realize and understand, and I'm sure in many ways you've seen and been awakened to it already, that there is an enemy prowling like a lion, seeking whom he may destroy. We know there's an enemy who comes to kill, steal, and destroy, and he is the father of lies. We live in a culture that has broken down the whole identity of family, and especially of fathers. We have a nation, we have children in an identity crisis. They don't know who they are. There's a show on TV, it's often only on late at night. It's a cable show called Long Lost Family. And two reporters spend the time trying to find families of people who have been adopted, and they want to know their identity. They want to know where they came from. We've had several counselors and kids at camp that have come and said, I got to figure out who I am. I don't know who I am. I don't know where I came from. And it's amazing that some of these people in the show, too, have been searching for 30 and 40 years and haven't been able to find their parents, their biological parents, and most of them will say, I will not rest until I find them. And it's amazing to hear them, and it's almost every situation, and I've seen maybe 30, 35 different episodes, and every one, maybe one not, has said, I finally know who I am. Our children are searching for their identity. We, and I'm going to single out dads, are the ones that they look to first. That's a daunting thought. That's a daunting responsibility, but it's one that I believe is God-given. We are called to be spiritual leaders of our homes. When I was growing up, my dad was an elder, deacon and elder. It wasn't that he wasn't a spiritual leader, but we recognized mom as being our spiritual leader in the home. And when I got married, Sherry's dad was obviously, clearly was the spiritual leader in that household. And so when we got together, I was expecting her to be, she was expecting me to be, and you know how that works. Not so well. And it took a long time for me to get it through there that it was my responsibility. I remember sitting at a Promise Keepers event, Ed Cole. There was 55,000 other men sitting there, but I believe with all my heart he was looking and told this story for my benefit alone. He said, a lot of you guys have promised, made promises that you don't keep. He said, I can imagine that there's somebody here that has told their son that you're going to go fishing. You promised them that not tomorrow, but the next day, or maybe the next day, that you're finally going to make good on the expectation of going fishing. And then that day comes, and he's got his fishing pole and tackle box in hand, ready to go fishing. And instead, you come up with a different excuse or different reason that, no, I can't go today. And he gets upset, throws it down, and then you get angry at him for having a bad attitude. And I thought, he was at our house. He must have been right there with me. And it just hit me and convicted me, like, where's my treasure? What am I, and don't get me wrong, I know working and earning an income and providing is an act of love. But there is a part in which our kids need to have FaceTime with us as dads. Jesus calls us to impress our children. Deuteronomy 6 verse 4. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your strength. These commands that I give you today are to be upon your hearts. Impress them. And that word actually means to leave a mark, to brand them. I'm not saying physically get out a branding iron, of course, but to leave such a mark that they will remember what you've talked about, what you've impressed them with. Talk about them when you sit at home and when you walk along the road, when you lie down, when you get up. That's day to day, every day, moment to the moment you get up to the moment they go to bed. Tie symbols on your hands and bind them to your foreheads. And carry messages around in a headband to remind them of different scripture verses. And we put different things on our door frames and in our houses to remind us of different scripture truths. I pray you're doing that. And I pray you take time to explain the things that are on your wall and why they're important to you. They need to know how important Christ is to you. Because the world is telling them that there's no place for God. There's no place for that kind of relationship. I love the Ortho commercial where there's this giant insect, right? He's knocking on the door. Everybody see that one? And he's not sure if he should really let him in. To me, it's a reminder of the enemy wanting to come and infest our homes. Well, we know he's not coming through the front door. We know he's coming through the TV cable or the internet cable. And some of us have no clue what's going on being allowed into our home. And the kids have access to it. Don't assume, don't be lazy about it, because the kids will find it. They know how to do it. So what is your job? And whose job is it? It's our job. It's the church's job to impress our children, to talk with them, to let them know and testify of who Jesus is, to make that a treasured relationship that will last all eternity. It said that I had both a good relationship and a not-so-good relationship with my dad. And for all the years that I was growing up, Dad was a tremendous encourager. There were times I got frustrated because he said, well, you can do that. And, well, no, I can't. I physically can't do it. But he would be there, right there. If I failed that at batter, he'd say, get up. You know, you can do it. Just keep trying. And I love that about him. And we had a good, healthy relationship. I knew and respected him. I knew the consequences of disobedience. In some ways, I feared him. But in most ways, I loved him. And then one day, he abandoned my mom and the family. I was married already. And for the next 4 or 5 years, it just shook the core of all our relationships. And my heart heart was so filled with anger and hate for him that I didn't think there was any possible way that I could ever say I love him again. And basically dismissed that relationship, didn't want anything to do with him. But God pursues us. He pursued Dad, and over time, Dad came back. Sometimes left again, but in the end he stayed, and God did an amazing work in our family. He brought healing and reconciliation to the point where I could honestly say I could actually hug my dad again. I was so angry with him one time I had tried to pull him out of the pickup with my hands around his neck to the pickup window. That's how angry I had been with him. And to think that burning anger inside could ever dissipate and disappear was just beyond my imagination. Till one day I woke up and it was like doing inventory, right? You got your wallet, you got everything else, yep, my anger was right there. And it was gone. It was gone. I don't know what kind of relationship you have with your dad or any parent, but I would encourage you that it's never too late, that there is always an opportunity for reconciliation, because we have a God at work. He reminds us of Psalm 23, surely goodness and mercy will, it says follow, but the word is radath. The God will pursue us all the days of our lives. And the psalmist concludes that I will live in the house of the Lord forever. God is after us. He's pursuing us. He's pursued us from the day we were born, wanting us and drawing us into a relationship with him. And he's created a treasure for us. He's created a relationship for us through Christ, reconciling our sin, our brokenness, so that we can live with him eternally. And the privilege of doing a funeral of a 100-year-old lady shortly after I left Ironton. She was a member of Ironton Church. She had a beautiful article in Northwest Iowa Review. And I asked her one time, so what are you looking forward to? Well, first she said, you have to understand that I have no friends around, because they're already gone. And I'm quite worried that they think I've gone to the other place. That was her sense of humor. So she said, I'm really looking forward to going there, but I don't care about them. I just want to see the face of Jesus. She'd been widowed for more than 40 years. First thing she wants to do is see the face of Jesus. I want to see the hands. I want to see his face and look into his eyes and tell him how much I love him. And then I might get to everybody else. That's her treasure. That should be our testimony. Often I hear, in fact, there was a survey done, 80% of the people are looking forward to something in heaven rather than being with Christ in heaven. We're even losing focus of why we ought to be there. We have all sorts of opportunities and privileges to call on our God and Father for help. We certainly, when Dad was going through all this, we were certainly on our knees and praying, and there were many other people praying. And it came to a point where we didn't even know what to pray for other than pray help. So if you're a dad or a grandpa or any one of us not sure how to grow in that relationship, the first place is just go, Lord, help me. Help me in my unbelief. As simple as that. That's what we tell our kids when they come to the hill as well. We have all sorts of opportunities to teach and preach Christ. That's our primary goal. And more of the kids that we have are coming with an identity crisis. They don't know who they are. Even the kids that come from good homes are being affected by all the trauma and the things that are happening around us. Growing up, and this is scientifically put together, but my own story, growing up when I was 7 years old, I saw one guy on TV that my parents didn't know I was watching. It was some old Western of a guy getting shot and dying. You know how many kids see people being killed today in a year, that age? It's thousands. There's so much our kids are being exposed to, and more they fall into this category of trauma affected, and it decreases their capacity to learn. It actually shuts down part of their brain because it's part of their survival mode kicking in. And as scientists and neurologists and psychologists are finding that we can retrain the brain, and kids can develop a relationship, which for some is almost impossible to do because of the way their brain is shut down. So we want to offer a solution and point these kids to Christ. We can't do it, but God can. And we hold this verse up often and remind ourselves that we're just the instruments and tools of God, and this is His army. We have 28 counselors that come, some are staff counselors, and we have about 2.5 to 3 weeks of training with them, and we have different people come in and help us teach them to help these kids. One of the groups is called Journey Camp, and last year we had, 52 kids from foster homes, refugee families, parents in prison, something else maybe through the court system. And the kids that come off the bus the first year are just a blank slate. They don't want to connect. They're not sure how to connect. And to develop a relationship with them is really tough. But there is a way. And it starts with showing them God's love, that they're safe. And then you can see the wall begin to crumble. I tell a number of stories about how that has played out, but one in particular, a young man came, he was 14 years old, and just didn't want anything to do with anybody. And then I told the story about my dad. And afterwards, he came to me, and for the next few hours, he just wept. He literally just wept. Come to find out that 6 weeks prior to that day, he found his father dead. He still had no answers of why he had died, but he missed his dad. So I'm going through all this crap at school, I'm going through all these trials, and I need him. I need him in my life. And he just cried and cried and cried. So why, God, did you take him now? We spent a lot of hours together, and finally it was time, it was getting late. I said, you need to get some rest. And I said, you need to ask God for help. Next morning, he came into my office and gave me a big hug. He looked completely different. He had a smile on his face. He said, I don't understand God's plan, but I know God loves me. And that's going to be good for now. He did the opportunity. He's coming back this year to be a junior counselor. I just can't wait to talk to him and hear what's been going on in his heart and his life. God is doing an amazing work in him. And he can do the same in our lives, in our children. God is at work. There are many kids who are lost. You have a tremendous opportunity as a community to be that vessel, that love of Christ. And I pray that this community will forever be changed by the work that God has called you to do. Let's pray together. Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you for the hope that we have in Christ, for life, Lord, with you in eternity. But for some of us, Lord, we live now in a troubled time, in a difficult time. And we ask, Lord, that you would just guide us in how we are to respond to our changing culture. Lord, I pray that this church would be a beacon in the darkness, that would be a place of love and of grace and of hope. I pray that, Lord, for us at camp as the kids come and as we do the work, Lord, that you've called us to do as a church and as a camp, Lord, to bring honor and glory to you. And Lord, we pray that your spirit would go ahead and prepare hearts and lives and draw them close to you. Father, we know that it is not our work that makes a heart change. Only you can do that. And you call us into a relationship, Lord, to grow closer to you, but also closer to those we call our neighbors. Those, Lord, around us who are broken and hurting and in need and looking for an identity. Lord, we praise you for the new building, the things, Lord, that we can do now here, with the facilities that we have. Lord, for the opportunities that you give us in doing outreach with Kids Fest, with the group that's down in Mexico now, Lord, we thank you for those opportunities and pray for just amazing things to happen in transforming hearts and lives. Lord, we praise you for World Renew and the things that they're doing overseas and domestically. Lord, we pray that you would equip and empower, that we would be, Lord, the churches that encourage and pray and support in prayer and financially, so that the kingdom, Lord, your kingdom, would continue to grow and claim hearts and lives. Lord, as we do that, we pray for other opportunities. And Lord, I praise you for those who have volunteered in doing that, showing love for those who are doing Meals on Wheels or doing other things within the community. Lord, with the upcoming meal tomorrow at Living Water, we pray that meal, Lord, would bring people in and that treasures would be built. Lord, we too continue to pray for those who are starting off with a new chapter in their lives, for Summer and Jordan as they were married, and for Taylor and Chandler as they look forward to their wedding. Lord, equip them, help them, and they experience your power and love in their lives. We pray, Lord, for hope and healing for Lyle and Teresa and their family. As they mourn and grieve, may they, Lord, know that you are right there beside them. May they experience that. Pray, Lord, for Jerry and others, Lord, who are dealing with health issues, Lord. We submit them to your care, to your keeping, knowing that you are the one who has knit us together. We are fearfully and wonderfully made, Lord, in your image. Just ask that they would, all those who need healing, Lord, would experience your presence in their lives. Lord, there are other things that may be on our minds, maybe our relationships with our fathers, maybe many things, Lord, we can't change, or maybe we don't seem to know how to let go of. In that, Lord, we pray for healing, for you to do abundantly more than we could ever ask or imagine because of the work and the power that is in us through Jesus Christ. Lord, may we know together with all the saints how high and wide and deep your love is for us. And that, Lord, we would be your church, your bride, bringing honor and glory to you. Father, this we pray and ask in Jesus' precious and holy name. Amen.
Sometimes it's difficult to think of putting our treasures in heaven because the things of this earth draw us back. Do I need to spend that extra time? Do I need that extra money? And I get concerned about those things. But the truth is, if we walk with Christ, we need to ask with this next song, whom shall I fear? If the God of angel armies is on my side, why do I need to be afraid? Let's stand and sing together.
Thank you.
God's parting blessing. May the God of hope fill you with joy and peace as you trust in him, so that you may overflow with hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen.